having issues with the sound.
Oh, okay.
Where do we gotta go?
I could hear you, though.
Oh, okay. Did you want to restart over, or?
No, that's for the record, fine. Or? No, I mean, I just want to thank everybody for their work on the budget. Sorry, Councilor Morantz.
Oh, sure. I just wanted to thank you for that, Mr. Mayor. And I think what I'd like to say is when we came to office, a number of the issues we were hearing from other councilors in the past, that there was a lack of inclusivity, and that the budget was perceived to have been done sort of by a small group of councillors and EPC, and then just proposed at the last minute without any attempt at outreach or consultation with other councillors. And as you know, like when you ran, you ran on the basis of openness and transparency, and that doesn't just mean with the community at large, it means with all of council. And so when we came in, we had a number of discussions around how we can include other councillors in the budget process. And we came in, you know, there was an election, and so we had an abridged time to deal with the budget. And of course, I was learning. I had never done a budget before, so I call it budget immersion, spending hours and hours basically with the public service trying to understand the intricacies and sophistication of the city budget. But we wanted to still find a way to bring other councillors in. And so we started by having individual meetings with councillors. And those were meetings between me and councillors, trying to learn what their concerns are and try as best as I could to bring them forward into the budget process. I'm told by every councillor that I spoke with that this had never happened before and that this was new and that they welcomed it. The second thing we did that had never been done before is that we held a council seminar to talk about the budget. And again, many of the councillors who were not on EPC came forward and said, well, this is great. We had never had this before. This is new. We welcome this. And then another thing that we did was there were issues around public amenities that came forward from the public service with respect to pools and waiting pools and issues and so forth. And the public service had legitimate concerns over the fact that there were some pools, not every pool in the city, but some pools that were crumbling in terms of infrastructure, in terms of the condition of the pools, and that they were underutilized. And they know the utilization because we have staff at the pools, and they keep track of how many people come. And so there were concerns around underutilization of these services. And so the community service came forward and said, is there anything that you want to do about this? And at EPC, we thought we were going to just continue on with the efforts that we had made at outreach with other councillors. So in addition to my meeting with the individual councillors, in addition to our having the council seminar, we decided to have community service go out and speak with each individual councillor to have a discussion about amenities in their wards and whether they could be realigned in some fashion. And so that's what we did in an atmosphere of openness and trust. And we never slated, as some of the news articles had suggested. We had never proposed. We had never budgeted for. And in fact, there are no closures of waiting pools at all budgeted for in the budget, or other pools for that matter, or rec centers for that matter. So I just wanted to clarify for the public that the perspective they're getting in the media around these issues is not accurate. And there will be no such closures. And in fact, we listen to the concerns of councillors in these discussions, not proposals or slated closings or budgeted for items. We listened to their concerns. We came back to EPC and we said, well, yeah, they have a point, and maybe we need to find another way to look at this in the future. And so I think it's important to clarify the record for the public. That they need not be concerned about what they're reading in the media around the issue of closures of these kinds of amenities around pools.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Is there any other discussion? Okay. Councillor Barotti is not here. Do we need a... No? Okay. Sounds good. Okay. Let's, in terms of delegates, I understand Councillor Eady is here?
Yep. Councillor Eady.
Councillor Eady. Thanks. Yes, sir. Welcome.
Yeah, I'm
I'm here on the law. Thank you, Mayor. I'm on the lobbyists, on the report on the lobbyists. I know the budget is a very difficult thing to do, and I don't want to, I won't speak to it at this point because I'm very, I got to catch a bus. I have a meeting right away with some university students with the, I'm going to talk to them actually about advocacy. Oddly enough, advocacy, lobbying, whatever you want to call it, but I'm talking to them about how they can have input and advocate for better things through the civic, our municipal structure and so on, and we know it's changing a bit. So I'm going to rush off. I got to catch a bus. So just quickly, though, so I'm not going to get into big detail on the whole lobbyist. It's a very lengthy, a very explanatory motion that was put forth. There's a number of different options to explore. I only have one concern, though, with the reference from the governance, and that is simply that our audit, it's what's happening here is we're putting this into the auditor's domain, the lobbyist registry, which is not quite, I don't think, would follow up on his mandate. However, it could, but my point is just simply our auditor, who has very limited resources, and I did explore the budget, and I know what limited budget amounts of money he has and the people power he has, and they have I think all the councillors now have met with him about his audit plan for the next 4 years, which is quite robust for a small office like his. And as you know, for 2014, he had to request extra money to go over budget in order, because of all the things he was dealing with. So I think that it's much preferable if, and I know all of our administration is they're very lean. There's been a lot of so-called efficiencies found over the years, and they're very lean. But I think this lobbyist registry is more of a legal department option to consider. And given that the auditor is also responsible for monitoring the progress of a whole ton of recommendations regarding the three audits, I think that I would ask EPC, with their wisdom and mayor, to actually have legal explore this, because there are some legal aspects that I think go beyond what the auditor would deal as well. And you know, there's options there. It talks about joining the Manitoba registry, province of Manitoba's. I'll just point out in there that the enforcement of that lobbyist registry is somewhat wanting as to who has to register and that sort of thing. So maybe the Toronto model for lobbyists is better, but I think it's better dealt with by the legal department. So I'll just leave you with that.
Thank you very much, awesome. Councillor. Just for clarity, and for those that are watching in the live stream, or for our members of the media that are here, the committee report that we're going to be considering shortly references it's a governance committee recommendation that, among other things, resolves that council requests that the governance committee review the options available to the city to introduce a lobbyist registry itself, or if the City of Winnipeg could be included in the provincial legislation, the Lobbyist Registration Act, together with other municipal jurisdictions. So at this point, it's really just tasking the governance committee to review those options.
The governance report refers to having the auditor department assist, and I think it's the legal department that should be assisting governance in this review, just because the auditor has a huge plate in front of them, and I think it would be prudent to do that.
I'll maybe just ask if is legal involved in reviewing right now?
And I can just assure you that we have been working with the auditor on our response to come back from the initial motion. This motion would then be included in that response, so that legal services is already and will continue to be involved in preparing that response.
Okay. Good. Okay.
Terrific. Thank you very much. Thank you. Councillor Mays.
Yeah, just in relation to that, and I want to thank Richard Ketcher for pointing this out to people like me who had forgotten that there was a motion in March from Councillor Fielding on a lobbyist registry that I don't think we ever fully disposed of. It talked about, be it resolved that the lobbyist registry be administered through the city auditor, and then an annual report filed by the city auditor on activities and registrants, and that the city auditor recommends penalties for violation of the lobbyist registry. So obviously there was some thinking back in March that the auditor should be running it, so we got to take a look at that motion from 2014 in conjunction with the new motion, I think, and try and figure out. Obviously, some people back in 2014 thought it should go through the auditor, and maybe that thinking has changed, but we're trying at the governance committee to get those two motions considered together and figure out which way to go with it. So it is a good, it's a good concept. I think it's just trying to figure out where it should end up in the bureaucracy.
Yeah. If, anyway, I would just point out, you know, you just go through the budget process. I would just point out, though, that if responsibility there, like that office is going to require more people. That's all I'm saying.
Thank you very much.
Whichever way is decided, the whole thing is there'll be some money associated with it.
Right.
So, yeah. Anyway, thank you very much.
Thank you, and thanks to Councillor Gervasi also for your leadership on this initiative. Appreciate it. Have a great day. Okay, let's move to reports. First is Animal Services SOA 2015-17 Business Plan.
Yes, Mr. Mayor, I'd be happy to move this report. It was considered by ASD on the 19th of January and also by Protection Community Services on January 30th, so I'd be happy to move that.
Okay, thank you. Discussion? Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Carried, thank you. Committee reports. Standing Policy Committee on Protection and Community Services, there's no report. Standing Committee on Property and Development. First one is extension of time, proposed subdivision rezoning of land located 740 John Bruce Road East.
Yep, so moved.
Okay, discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Carried, thank you. Report two. Which is rescinding of May 24th, 2006 council decision to declare 1201 Archibald Street surplus to the needs of the city.
Yep. Just for EBC's knowledge, this is for the new library. It was declared surplus before, but then after looking at some other options, it was determined that this would be the best place for the new library. So we just have to go back and rescind the previous motion. And that's what we're here for today.
Councillor Mays.
It's good. This is a good policy initiative. I think, and the old library, the current library location will become surplus and be disposed of, whereas this land is now going to be used because it's adjacent to, it's across the parking lot from the indoor pool. So a very good initiative. Councillor Vandal spearheaded this. So it's, we need, and I'm told as of yesterday, they anticipate having the library built and open by 2016. So hopefully they'll keep to that commitment in the library branch because it'll be a great amenity.
Yep, I agree.
It's incredible to see the work that's going on in the libraries. I know Councillor Morantz and I were at the opening of the new Charleswood Library, and it's been as a parent, but also as mayor, it's been pretty amazing and really impressive to see the work that's going on to really refurbish and reinvent what libraries are.
Yep.
I think if you haven't been in a library and if you're watching or reading about this, I would encourage people get out and enjoy our libraries. They really are incredible. The Charleswood Library, you know, what was really fun about the opening, of course, was the fact that the children from Ecole, it was Dieppe School, helped create a line of students to move the books. And the interior is—I mean, it's not just books and shelves. I mean, there's learning areas. It's really incredible. So,
yeah. If I just may add to that, it was really an incredible day. Probably one of the best days I'd say I had since I arrived here. And the book chain was fabulous. Basically, we lined up along Roblin Boulevard with 100 or so children from Dieppe, and we literally passed books hand to hand from the old library to the new library. And of course, as chair of finance, I was quite excited by the fact that we didn't have to hire a courier to have them delivered. It was a cost savings measure. But no, all kidding aside, it was a wonderful experience to pass books hand to hand. The kids had a great time. The kids, I think, will spend a lot of time at that library, and many future generations of children will enjoy it and learn by it. So it's a wonderful thing.
I'm certainly going to spend a little bit of time there with my two boys. Yeah. So, anyways, if there's no other discussion, I'll call a question. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Carried. Thank you. Governance Committee. This is the first one is proposed ward name changes.
If I may speak to this briefly, Mr.
Please.
Mayor. So this came up shortly after the election. Both Councillors Gillingham and I felt that there was a need within our communities for a ward name change. In my case, everyone calls our ward Charleswood Tuxedo White Ridge. White Ridge is a distinct community in and of itself and is part of the ward. And there was no question as I was going door to door that they felt underrepresented. And so this is just an attempt to bring them into the fold. This matter was at EPC before, was referred back to governance. We had discussions about this at governance, and the governance committee felt it was appropriate to refer it back to EPC at this time for our agenda today. I might add, I have had discussions with the clerk's office, and there's really no or significant cost at all to the city's treasury in making these changes. And so my recommendation is that we move this forward to council for approval. So I would so move the adoption of this report.
Thank you. Any further discussion?
My comment is just regarding number two, that I'm assuming the city clerk will consult all the ward councilors then, because I too had the same challenge, and I guess then it will come forward also.
Yes. Absolutely, sure.
Yeah, great.
I mean, I think we just brought it forward. We had motions prepared.
Yep.
By the clerk around this idea, and I'm sure they would do the same thing for other other councillors, and we can bring this forward. Yeah.
There be the slippery slope.
I know.
I'll allow individual councillors to decide what they're doing. Mm-hmm. I have the same problem with a neighborhood. I have, 22 distinct neighborhoods in my ward. Crescentwood may not feel underrepresented, so I put, River Heights, Crescentwood, Linden Woods, Brooke, all the 21 names in there. That's why we usually keep them more regional in Fort Garry and River Heights, and they encompass larger areas. I understand the need to do this for individual councillors, and I'll respect that. But again, it does set a precedent for other places, people now, where I'll probably get some calls from some of my Linden Ridge, for example. It's a small little neighborhood, but they're feeling very underrepresented because they're very far outside. Doesn't matter how many times I walk it and knock it, that's the way it is. So that's a slippery slope you're starting.
You don't knock it, you knock on their doors.
Knock on the doors.
Sorry.
The neighborhood.
Yeah.
So no matter how many times you do this, there's always a neighborhood that will feel that they're not part of it. So it'll get pretty cumbersome to have 21 different names in one ward. So again, I'm taking the slippery slope part. This, sure. Again, I'll leave it to individual councillors. There is the other idea, but maybe we'll talk about a later date, which is other cities do, where they just call it tiers or precincts or whatever. They just make more generic names even. I don't like that model because I think the distinctive of our communities, which makes Winnipeg so great. So I'll let this one go for sure. I'll let the area councillors decide what they want to do. But just I want to point out the slippery slope we're starting.
I will not be proposing that my ward name be changed to anything other than Winnipeg. So I'll let
not
the
yeah.
Okay. Well, I'll call a question. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, carried. Thank you. I think we've got one other matter, which Councillor Eady spoke to earlier. It's the lobbyist registry.
I'll move the governance committee recommendation. It's found at number two.
I'll just echo my comments on this. I mean, these are the types of initiatives that we were hired to bring in. And so I would commend Councillor Eady and Councillor Gervasi's work on this, as well as members of EPC and other members of council that may be weighing in and will in due course. So any other discussion?
Nope.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Carry.
That's it.
Yeah, consent to adjourn it.
Sure.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thanks very much. Have a great day, everyone.
You too.